whispering while the hair is lashed. Doom and Cursed Hollow. Feels like both teams want to play large maps. Yeah, well, Towers of Doom, it's a good Vikings map, so we will get to see something like that. Good point. Thank you. Sounds good. Test, test, 1, 2, 3.
Hey guys, and welcome to another day of Hero Lounge. I am Heartless. Hello, and nice to meet you. This is the first time I'm actually showing my face on camera. So I hope you guys are not too scared. Anyway, today I'm being joined by Carvis Joker, who's going to co-cast with me. Hey Carvis, how are you doing today?
Hello Heartless, it's good to be here. I'm looking forward to these games in Division 2.
All right, awesome. Me too. Actually, I haven't got the chance to cast either of the team. I know that at least Crocodox played in the past. Not sure about Vis Inertia. But teams are actually both ready and about to draft. So before we jump into the draft, I just want to go and have a quick look over the maps that we have today for you guys. Also, by the way, feedback on in chat, especially on Carvis's volume. Let me know, guys, if it's fine. Or you know, if it needs any tuning. So back into the maps here, we had really quick two bans here of both Garden of Terror and Battle of Eternity. Garden, not a big surprise, I would say. Battle of Eternity is quite a new ban, at least from my point of view. What do you think, Arvis?
Well, I think Battlefield of Eternity is easy to have a pocket pick, go with Sylvanas and be really good at Immortal Phase. And it could be a ban that maybe as an amateur you're not prepared for. So I think it's a good ban for a map pick.
Alright, I quite agree with you on this one actually. And as far as map picks goes, we had, let me see here if I can find this. Where is it? I kind of lost it. Okay, there we go. So the first map we had picked today is going to be Infernal Shrines, followed by Towers of Doom, and hopefully Cursed Hollow. So two very big maps. Towers of Doom, not the biggest map, of course. Very elongated, but very narrow in the middle. Lots of team fights happening very often there. What do you think about the maps?
Well, especially Infernal Shrines is the usual map most people go to. It's like a larger Battlefield of Eternity, so not much to say there. But Towers of Doom, it's a potential Vikings map. And it's also a map where you can get a lot of value out of picks like Stitches, maybe Chromie, and lots of poke potential. So it's quite a different map.
Yeah, I agree. I personally love Infernal Shrine. It opens up gameplay for both Zul, Sylvanas, and Kerrigan, which are really, at least Kerrigan and Sylvanas are really two of my favorite heroes. So as far as Infernal Shrine goes, I absolutely love it. Towers of Doom, less so. It's probably one of my personally most hated maps. Nothing too specific. I just just really don't like how everything is kind of like mashed in the middle there. But it's a fine map. Like, don't get me wrong, it's not as bad as Blackheart's Bay. It's not as bad as Garden of Terror, but still. And Cursed Hollow, as you said, huge map, open for Lost Vikings, also very strong for Zagara because she can, you know, oftentimes get herself kind of alone there at you know, either lane she's assigned to and get a lot of damage.
Yeah, I think, you know, the split push potential in Cursed Hollow and also the ability to boss control and, you know, play the map, also a strong map, and it's going to be interesting to see what they can do.
Yeah, definitely. So I think without too much talking, we can go straight into the draft here. Let me just set it up for you guys, for me personally. And draft has started. Let's go here.
A quick Sylvanas band from this inert.
And there we go. Alright, so we have here, yeah, quick Sylvanas ban. This is a respectful ban. I like it. As I mentioned, she's one of the strongest heroes here together with Zul, so I'm not surprised to see her. And Crocodox gonna go follow up with a Zagara ban immediately.
Both are, well, Sylvanas is more push with the Immortal, and Crocodox don't want to mind the split push potential of Zagara. And also a Zul pickup earlier from this inerty.
All right, and a Zul pick here by this inertia, very good choice by them. How will Crocodux gonna respond to it? Because it opens up a lot of problems, especially early on, especially if the shrine is gonna spawn either at the top or at the bottom. All of a sudden, Zul can just, you know, rotate between two lanes and do a lot of pressure and get a ton of value, while both teams are fighting against the first, you know, Punisher, which has very minimal effect there in the early game.
Yeah, probably it's either, you know, the potential to go for ganking Zul early in the before the Immortal phase, or get a good wave clear yourself to, you know, just minimize the damage he can do, and then try to have stronger composition at the shrine.
Yeah, definitely. Hold on, guys. All right, let's see if this will be better. There were some complaints about your volume. See if this helps out with this issue here. Okay. So we'll see if it works out. Anyway, so we have a quick follow-up here with ETC Kael'thas, very, very strong combo. We see this those two actually going together in a lot of maps because they just offer this early game pressure in safety, and you know what, they're kind of neutral as far as map goes, so you know, their composition, their duo strength can just work out pretty much anywhere. So not a big surprise here by this inertia to go on with the ETC and the Kael'thas pick, but Crocodox, they went with the Jaina pick here.
A Jaina pick this early is kind of unusual because she's not usually the mage getting banned out. Maybe it should more be used as a pocket pick. And the Brightwing ban coming out from Crocodox. Obviously they're afraid for the polymorph, probably on the Graeming jumping in.
Yeah, so they went with a quick Brightwing ban here, and this inertia, how are they going to respond to it? Kerrigan is still open. Their front line from this inertia's point of view is still open, so they might actually go with the Kerrigan themselves. So I guess they're going to go with an Uther ban here. Kind of afraid of the Greyman Uther Tyrael triple here that we sometimes see, actually, that we actually see quite often, surprisingly enough, despite the fact that it's amateur scene. We see those three, you know, doing a lot of work together. So they're gonna go with an Uther ban here, which is a good choice. It's a really good choice here, especially considering they got the Greyman. But Crocodox, how are they gonna protect the Greyman? They're gonna secure the Rhaegar, but I really wonder if they're gonna go with the Tyrael. No, instead they're gonna go with Tassadar, but they still can go with the Tyrael, which means there's gonna be a ton of protection for Greyman.
Yeah, if to go with the Tyrael, it could be lots of protection for Greyman, but they will have to watch out for the flanks from ETC, you know, going in and grabbing that early stun, because with the combo from Kel'Fest you can blow up a Jaina in a second, and that also goes for Greyman.
Yeah, so we will see how Visnesha responds to this futurist, you know, what's going to be the future Tyrael here as well, together with the Greyman and the double support here onto him. They really, I feel like they really need to get some strong frontliner, because Zul just doesn't cut it as a frontliner. ETC sure has a lot of potential to do a lot of damage, especially with his Mosh, and especially considering the composition that Crocodox has. They have no interruption for Mosh so far, except for the potential possible Tyrael that they haven't picked just yet with Sanctification, which still doesn't stop the Mosh necessarily, just provides a protection to those that actually are inside the Sanctification. But we will see. So yeah, they're gonna go with a double frontliner here from Visinertia, double tank, very, very EU meta. Not a big surprise here.
Yeah, I like the Arthas pickup. He's so strong, and usually he brings a lot of damage, so people might be surprised by how much he can deal out, and it's difficult for Greyman to move about with Arthas standing around, slowing him down, rooting him, especially in the late game.
Yeah, definitely. I would actually would love to see a Sonya instead of the Arthas here. She completely destroys anyone who is close to her, and I don't care if you're a Greymane, a Thrall, Illidan, she just doesn't care. But plus it's Infernal Shrines, and she has an amazing control over the skeletons. She can just so effectively and easily grab all the skeletons. They heal her, doesn't cost her mana, so she has really amazing utility here. But as it stands, they're going to go with an Arthas, and as a respawn, Crocodux, not going with a Tyrael. They're going to go with a Johanna. Very interesting.
Yeah, that's interesting. Probably, maybe they felt a bit low on the wave clear, and they want a Johanna, and... But I don't really feel it. Maybe, well, probably for the interrupt and the ETC mush bit, Johanna got two with Blessed Shield, and also if you time your Condemn.
Oh, yeah, good. With your Iron Skin, definitely.
Yeah.
But I have two problems here. One, we don't see the Grey material composition, which means that, yeah, you have Ancestral, yeah, you have Tassadar, and you know what, it might be enough. But still, Greyman can be shut down so quickly between ETC, Kel'Thas, and Zul with Bone Prison. So they might actually need the extra protection in the form of Sanctification. That's my one problem. But my biggest problem is, how do you respond to Zul? How do you respond to Zul? He's going to have an amazing wave clear. Who do you have?
They probably will have to put Tassadar against Zul, but he's going to lose that battle. But I don't see any other... can't see them sparing any other from the shrine control. So they're going to have a tough time dealing with the split push.
Yeah, I have to agree. I'm so worried about the early game. Their ability to contest Zul, the immense lockout that they have here between ETC, KT, Zul, on whoever, you know, they want to kill. Plus you have double tank versus a gray main. It looks very scary for Crocodox here, but we will see if they actually manage to make it happen. You know, winning a draft, as we've seen time and time again, doesn't necessarily mean you've won the game.
No, indeed. And especially, yeah, the lockdown coming down. As a Greyman player, you have to be so careful when you jump in now, because unless you're absolutely certain you will get that Kel'Fest kill or you get that soul kill, you can't jump in, because you're going to get caught down in a bone prison or a gravity lapse or whatever Arthas or ETC throws at him.
Yeah, definitely. So we are gonna start, the game is loading now, so we will move to it. Yeah, definitely they have a long way, a rough road ahead of them, let's just say that that way, for Crocodox here on the left side with their composition. Very, very interesting composition from both of them. They are putting all their eggs in the gray main, so to speak, and we'll just have to see if it's going to pay off. I mean, I expect him to take on level 7 the Wizened Duelist, the talent that allows him to stack upon kills. So he's kind of going to be their main source of damage, and we'll just have to see if they can make him work.
Yeah, they kind of need to get that kill snowball rolling to you know, get Greyman to that god mode. The problem is, the other team, they have the better early game comp, so they'll have trouble to keep up in XP.
Definitely. So we are starting the game here on the left side of the map. We have Crocodox with Shiny on Greyman, Kadolek on Tassadar, Ankoro on Rhaegar, Amiria on Jaina, and Subco on Johanna.
And the right side, we have Astacopi on ETC, Peter on Kel'Thas, Arasol on Sul, Ninetales on Arthas, and Captain Raynor on Karazhan.
Yeah, so we will see how they respond here for the Zul composition. Usually this map is a 1-4 split. You're going to have one guy soloing the top lane, four people rotating between mid and top. Between mid and bot, and kind of getting a lot of value. So we will see how they respond to it. By the way, as far as talents go here, in the beginning here in level 1, we have Knight take spawn for Johanna, together with Wolfheart for Greymane. Not too special. Tassadar still hasn't decided. I expect Conjurer's Pursuit. They do expect long fight here with double support and a Johanna. So yeah. I would imagine that would be it. Yeah, and he locks in the Conjurer's Pursuit here.
Sul actually went into the backlash, so maybe it doesn't feel like with the longer cooldown on the Shade. And maybe for that extra damage on the Greyman when he jumps in.
Yeah, very interesting pick there. Not sure if I like it too much. Ooh, and we have here an engagement here, and Greyman is getting very low. He does have 61 hit points, and he just manages to blown up here by KT's Living Bomb there. Very nice job by them, grabbing a first quick kill here on the side of this Inertia.
Yeah, Greyman getting caught out of position when he goes for an aggressive rotation. And you know, against an ETC, a Sul, and a Kel'Thas, you can't do that.
Yep, and their rotation, by the way, is working out pretty nicely. They are rotating in 3, not as 4, leaving Karazim kind of there in the middle lane there, but it's kind of fine for them.
Oh, nice lockdown on Rhaegar here, but I don't think they get quite enough damage.
No, so Rhaegar just barely manages to escape there, despite the fact that they did get some lockdown on him. Very good job by them, putting a lot of pressure right as the Shrine is about to spawn here, which means that they are forcing a tap here very quickly from Crocodox.
Well, it's still a good position for Crocodox. The worst position for them would have been the top lane, but still Sul can get some good work done here.
Hold on a thing, I think my game is a bit lagging. Should be fine now. Yeah, there we go.
Okay.
Yeah. There we go. So yeah, some good get the damage here on Johanna here. Missing the roots from... Ooh, nice power slide here by ETC here. Grabbing here the Jaina from Kel'Thas. Very good job by them. And it's going to be a 1-for-nothing here. And I think this is kind of going to secure them the Shrine here. They are enough ahead in skeletons. Or not ahead, but they have collected enough skeletons to where... they actually can lock down the Punisher, possibly. We'll
yeah,
see.
They should have no problem, and they're ahead in XP, so they should get them a good lead.
Yeah, definitely, but you know what, they have banned Sylvanas at the beginning, so no Punisher Sylvanas shenanigans in this game, sadly, which means that the Punisher, especially the first one here, won't do too much value, I don't think so.
But the value you can get from the Sul in another lane at the same time as the Punishers go on and do his John Cena stuff can be worth it anyway.
Yeah, and a little bit unfortunate, by the way, that the Punisher kind of spawned in the middle and not in one of the edges, you know, kind of allowing Zul to double rotate while the Shrine is active. Yeah. It's always good to see early game.
See? Crocodox had trouble pulling in the Immortal behind the gate, so we're getting a lot more value from the first Immortal than maybe you should be used to.
Yeah, but I have to say props to both teams. They know that the Punisher, the first Punisher anyway, is very underwhelming, so they didn't lose too much sleep over him. They send Arthas to the top there and Zul to the bottom to just soak experience. And on the side of Crocodox, they also send one player to each lane to soak it during the Punisher.
Yeah, they know that the most important thing is not to lose that minion XP during the first phase, because that XP will never come back.
Yeah. Ooh, and a nice power slide here on Greymane, catching him a little bit off position here, but the stun from KT doesn't land, and this means that Greymane will survive.
And a good zoning from the Johanna there. No.
By the way, Tassadar versus Arthas at the top lane, not the best matchup out there. Arthas slowly but surely bullying Tassadar away from the lane, kind of taxing him there as far as the towers go and the mana goes. So I think like Crocodox, they might need to address it at some point here.
Yeah, that's obviously a losing battle, but the problem is Sul. They can't spare a person, because then Sul will get so much more value.
Yeah, and that's exactly what we were talking about earlier. The Pixel and the lack of answer from the side of Crocodox can be really taxing on them, especially as far as wave clearing goes. So I'm really just worried about how are they going to deal with him throughout the game here, because Zul's pressure is not something that you need to be afraid of early on. It's just something that's going to be, you know, that's going to keep happening throughout the game.
And with the new shrine spawning, it's a one level lead for Viz here.
Yeah,
and they'll call them.
Yeah, and they are doing the top shaman camp, Arthas at least soloing, and I feel like it's a little bit too late there, especially if you go there solo as an Arthas. By the way, they are doing a very good decision here. They are delaying the shrine in a sense, right? They are trying to get to their level 10 here, and I love it. I think they could have done a slightly better job, of course, but you know, as it stands, they are not really trying to contest it, not yet. They are trying to get their level 10 here.
Yeah, the idea is really good. The problem is now, Crocodox is so far ahead in their minion count, so they might end up being another backlash.
Yeah, definitely. I think they had a good idea. The execution, of course, needed improvement here. By the way, Johanna is getting caught on position here. Nice gravity lapse by KT, securing that kill on her. And they do have their level 10 one-man mosh here on Tassadar. Poor Tassadar, but he does have his dimensional shift, which allows him to escape. But still,
Greymane managed to get the last minion, so at least they get the immortal.
Yeah, at least they have that. At least they have that.
And there's a camp pushing top lane. They need this respite to, you know, de-push the lanes, get the XP, try to get their level 10. They can't fight now.
Yeah, they can't fight now, definitely. They don't have the heroics there. They are setting Tassadar to the top. And it seems like they are trying to get some a little bit of extra value, poking kind of from afar behind their Punisher, but I feel like it's a little bit too risky. They are still very far from level 10, plus considering their composition, they really only have Jaina as a poke. How much damage can she solo, you know, as a solo poker do really? But you know what, they realized they backed off right in time, not allowing this inertia to get an extra value here by them having 10 and Crocodox not having 10.
Yeah, but seems to be going a team fight over at the siege camp. A great power slide by ETC, and maybe Crocodox is a bit greedy. They knew the other team was over there, and they still went for the camp. Maybe need to play a bit more safer before 10, and it was, you know, a great invade by Viz here.
Yeah, very nice job by having this game sense of just going and... ooh, nice power slide on Jaina here. I don't think she will be taken down. They're just... ooh, Gravity Lamp catches her past the Living Goal and the Flame Strike, but it shouldn't be enough. And she survives with 97 hit points. Kind of a hesitation there by both team, by Viz Inertia. They got the power slide on Jaina, but ETC kind of backed off, and then KT went inside with the Gravity Lapse. I think if they would be more decisive, they would have gotten the kill there on the Jaina. But as it is, she managed to escape with almost 100 hit points there.
Yeah, it can be hard to get the coordination with an amateur team to, you know, go in under a fort, grab that kill. People might not, you know, feel that might not be the right call, but they need to follow the shot caller, or they need to follow the tank and go in and grab those kills.
Yeah, definitely. It's one of the things that teams need to really practice upon, and it's the decisiveness of them, right? Even if it's not the most ideal decision that you make, oftentimes actually, just being decisive, just, you know, saying, guys, we're gonna go in, and not being afraid, and just, you know, trusting, it can lead to a lot of playmaking and a lot of, you know, good things coming towards you.
Yeah, you want the other team to feel scared. You know, they want, you want them to feel the pressure And also a nice camp capture here in the bot lane when the shrine is in the top lane. Jaina will have to clear that up, and that should get them far ahead in the minion count.
Yeah, as far as level 10 heroics go, by the way, for Crocodox, we don't see anything too special here. Ring of Frost for Jaina, so no water elemental here, which is a the smart choice here considering the composition of this inertia. Together with the blast shield here, giving them extra protection against the Mosh from Johanna here. But still, we'll need to see how they actually manage to deal with the Mosh. The last Mosh was kind of underwhelming. Only cut Tassadar, and he also managed to escape at the end, thanks to Dimensional Shift. But still, we'll see if they can get some extra value here for Mosh and the response from Crocodox too.
And it's also, it's the fear of the Mosh Pit.
Definitely.
The potential of him going in can be just as devastating. You hold off your stuns. I know, it's great. Great engage, great Mosh Pit.
Nice Mosh!
But you still don't get the kill, but Rhaegar should go down. And he does.
And we had like a great John Cena there, catching I think 3 or 4 of them right before the Mosh, and then he just slided in with the Mosh, trying to get extra people there. One managed to escape, but still a really good job here with the Mosh. Only catching Rhaegar though, so not the worst case scenario.
But to get a lot of value, they've taken down the wall, and this opens for potential push later in the game. They won't get much more value now. But no, that wall will always be open for them to just go in and grab that keep if ever they get 2 persons down or 3 persons down. It's get great value out of that Punisher.
Yeah, definitely. And by the way, so far in this game, KT, throughout his Gravity Lapse lockdowns here, managed to get a lot of damage done. 26,000 damage in total so far, as opposed to the number one from Crocodoc, which is Greyman, with merely 16k. So KT doing a lot of job here, a lot of pressure.
Yeah, and it is this double tank composition coming out of this. You know, Greyman, he can't go in and do that massive damage, even with a double support, and with when there are a talent down, he can't just jump in. He'll be instantly deleted, and he'll be CC'd for no end.
Yeah, definitely, especially considering they actually managed to get the Uther Ban on the side of Viz at the beginning here, kind of denying the potential for Greyman to just, you know, jump in and be immune, which is oftentimes a better case than getting Ancestral and being topped off.
Yeah, you know, health points can just do that much, but being immune can do so much more. Oh, great engage here. See if...
Ooh, they are gonna get a Bone Prison here on Jaina. She is locked. Arthas is closing in on her, but it doesn't look like he has his roots available for him. ATC is coming here from the flank from maybe a Power Slide here. He does have Mosh here. Good job with the Mosh, getting 3 people here, including Johanna, so no interruption. And all those people caught in the Mosh immediately evaporated there.
Yeah, they even got the Ring of Frost in against this here. But, you know, with Greyman down, it's just not enough damage to, you know, end the people. It's just a bunch. Doesn't do anything.
Yeah, definitely here. And they were like all clamped there together, just, you know, asking to get the ETC to just slide on top of them. And I'm really surprised about Johanna. She is the only interruption. She really needs to be careful, not only about her position, but does she have Iron Skin available, right?
Yeah, so you need to save it for those moments. You can't just be too cocky and going too far forward, but that's also that's the threat of the Mosh Pit. So you need to save it, and you need to be ready. It seems like we're getting another engage here, and I feel like Crocodox needs to fight now.
Yeah, they don't have level 16, but they have all their heroics available to them, and this is a nice engagement here. Already forcing Ancestral Healing here, but Johanna is pushing forward. She's dropping low, and she will be taken down, and Greyman follow her as well. This is a 2-for-0, and Rhaegar. And again, 3-for-0 here for the favor of this inertia.
Yeah, that didn't go as they wanted. Greyman did jump in, but he was instantly stunned, and he couldn't do anything.
And the Jaina as well, forward. Getting caught out of position here with the Power Slide and the Gravity Lapse. And you know what? This is a full hit points Punisher here, and the keep is already exposed. There's no front wall, and they might actually go for the core here.
Yeah, this is probably a game. If they just go and right-click that core, Tassara can't do anything. Graeme can come in, but what is going to do? He just gets rooted and killed in a second.
Yeah, definitely here, and game number one here, gonna go very decisively to Visinertia here with their strong ETC peak here with the great Masha throughout the game together with the KT combo. Just proved to be unstoppable for Crocodox. GG, well played.
Well played. What's the draft here? I think Graeman, he's great and he can do a lot of damage, but you can't leave him to do it all alone. He needs that enabling for the kills. That's when you get the most value from him.
Definitely, definitely. It seems like, and it's actually quite an interesting draft minus the Tyrael that we didn't see, because usually you have the Graeme together with protection as kind of a Korea meta. Tyrael makes a lot of difference, sure, but instead of a Tyrael, they decide, okay, we're going to go with double support for the Graeme. So we've seen on the one side the Korean meta, and it's not really Korean, it's also China, so I guess the Eastern meta versus the EU one, with the double tank, and it seems like EU meta kind of worked out better for them, but again, they didn't have the Tyrael, they didn't have really an answers for the Mosh, only the Johanna, so definitely could have done better.
I think if we're talking EU versus Eastern meta, I think the EU meta, it's easier to pull off, and it's stronger in amateur league because you need the mechanics to do this gray main, and you also need, they didn't have Divine Shield and they didn't have Sanctification, so he would always get CC'd. He just had one cleanse.
Definitely, definitely. And with that being said, we guys are going to go for a 2 minutes break, let the team kind of refreshing themselves and prepare for the next game. So stay tuned. It's going to be exactly 2 minutes break. I'll see you right soon.
Live yet? By the way, zoom out button. to zoom out. Yeah, no, for me. How to zoom out camera. Okay, thank you. Yeah, let's try that. Yeah. We're supposed to go through that, but yeah, we have to go, so. No, I think that you'll have to invite me again. Thank you.
Hey guys, and we're back. We had a really quick 2 minutes break. The teams are ready with the draft, so we'll just jump straight into it. Let me just set it up. And the map we're gonna have here is Towers of Doom. Let me just let the team know. You can start with draft. All right. And draft has started, so we'll move to it. That's the old one and the new one, and there we go. We are live and ready. So yeah, the map is Towers of Doom. It's one of Falstad's strongest maps. So I wouldn't be surprised if we're going to see a Falstad here within the first rotation here, whether being banned or picked. Who do you like on this map, actually, Carvis?
Yeah, Falstad is a personal favorite, or a lot of people's favorite. Brightwing is also good. Maybe not first pick material, but then it's also the Vikings on this map.
The
Extremely good.
Vikings.
Yeah, the potential to go for all three shrines at the same time and the push potential, it's great.
All right, so we have a really quick here Falstad ban here coming from Vestinertia. We're respecting his global and Crocodox, however, went for a Kerrigan ban here. Really surprised. It's not like we've seen Kerrigan last maps. It's not like they are afraid of her or can gouge her potential at the hands of Vestinertia. So I'm really surprised about this ban. However, they do go for the Zagara pick here, an extremely strong solo laner here, especially on Towers of Doom, which is a map where usually you're going to have people split throughout the three lanes. You don't see normally too many rotations here. They can happen, they do happen, but it's not something you normally see on this map.
Yeah, maybe. Oh, there goes
Oh, there go the
Vikings.
Vikings for you. Okay. Ooh, together with a gray main here, very interesting here.
Yeah, I think they're planning to go for a ganking composition for the rest of the four picks. And gray main, if you get a power slide in and you jump in with gray main, it's pretty much instant kill.
Definitely. I mean, this is pretty much a default when you see Vikings here. You're going to have the Vikings on every single layer, freeing up the four other heroes to basically do whatever they want. And especially early in the game, what they will want to focus on is going to be either getting a lot of early game ganks or alternatively get a Sylvanas and put a lot of pressure on a single lane. So we'll see how they respond. I mean, and you can have both, right? You can have both ETC and Sylvanas in your team together with the Lost Vikings and kind of have this mishmash of both, a lot of team fight potential together with a lot of pressure on buildings here. So we will see what they're actually going to go here. To supplement their Viking choice here. Crocodox, however, they went with an Arthas and a Li Ming. Li Ming, I love her on this map. This is oftentimes going to be a poke war around the objective, and with a Li Ming, you're usually not going to go with the Chromie, right? Chromie is like the ultimate poke machine here, but you just don't go for Chromie naturally. So, who you do go for is Li Ming, and Li Ming has an amazing poke potential. Long range on her abilities, a lot of damage from them if they connect. I love it.
Yeah, I think she's the safer choice. More people are used to play Li Ming, and also it's the potential for the resets on the Lost Vikings. Would they come to the great fight at the shrines?
Yeah, definitely. And here, by the way, they're gonna go with Brightwing ban here from Vestinertia. So really respecting the global, and I mean we can already see their plan, right? They banned the Falstad, they banned the Brightwing, they got the Lost Viking. So they are like, okay, guys, we have the global play here. That's our plan, and we can already see it. And it worked kind of nicely for them because nobody actually contested the Viking on the side of Crocodox before they picked it, and nobody took Brightwing as well. And I like it because those are not high priority picks anyway. So this is why they started with the Falstad and kind of snowballed their draft in the way they wanted. Crocodox, however, they're going to go with the Uther ban here. And again, this is going to be like last game, a respond to the gray main pick. So pretty standard from their point of view.
Yeah, I would be surprised if we don't get that ETC now. It would be really great together with the Greymen and the Vikings. They probably
Definitely.
went with Rhaegar when Uther was banned out because Uther is great with the ganking composition with the stun he brings. You know, it's no getting away from that. And
Yeah.
ETC comes out.
Yeah, definitely. You see, now the question is who's going to be their fifth? I wouldn't mind a Sylvanas on this map, actually. It allows you to push the towers early game. She provides a decent back line for them. Plus, her Wailing Arrow can do a lot of damage, but we'll see. I mean, KT is also open, right? So either Sylvanas or a KT, both of them are very, very good here. With the Sylvanas, they can press the towers. With KT, they can supplement their early game ganking potential. So we will see how they respond here, how they're gonna go and finish their composition here. Crocodox, double tank.
Yeah, double tank. I think that Nubarak is a counter pick to ETC here.
Ooh.
If they're not trolling us, I don't know, but maybe it's a counterpick to Greymane.
Demon Lily.
But does she, you know, have the potential to save someone who's getting absolutely ganked?
No, of course not. Yeah. That's why you don't pick Lily, generally speaking. She just doesn't have the on-demand heal, the focus heal, and her ultimate is heroic is very, very underwhelming. It just can't keep someone alive throughout the burst damage. And I mean, they already have a Greymane together with an ETC, and if it's gonna be a KT, it might be a disaster for them.
Yeah, they really need to. Their tanks are going to have to play on point and play it safe and really keep their Li Ming and Sagara alive. If ETC get a power slide onto Li Ming or Sagara, Kalfas.
And there we go, KT.
This could be a slaughter of the squishies on the side of Crocodox.
Yep, it is. So we are done with the draft. It seems like Vista Inertia has a very, very, very strong draft here. I'm really curious about this Lily pick. It's like, what were the thought process behind her?
I can't think of it really, except you know the blind on Greymane. I don't see her value in this game.
Yeah, and I mean I can also like kind of understand. I mean, if you look at the bans, we have an Uther ban and a Brightwing ban and a Rhaegar pick before the Lily. So, which healers are you really left with? A Malfurion, really a Morales.
I think
a Karazim. Karazim, it's like then you're like three melees. It's like so. I mean, don't get me wrong, Karazim would be much better, but I guess their support doesn't feel like he can lend those palms. So.
Yeah, maybe doesn't feel comfortable in playing Karazim, and maybe the best choice here is Lily, because maybe the support player is a really good Lily player and feels confident and can focus on the other things on the map and not just focus on playing their hero.
Yeah, so we will need to see a lot of communication between the teammates here on the side of Crocodox, because their tanks will need to do an absolutely amazing job here to peel off and not allow the ETC and Greymane to connect with their backline, because if they do, this is a disaster. Greymane can instantly delete Li Ming if he gets close enough, as well as the Zagara. So we'll need to see a lot of work here coming from Arthas and Anu protecting their backline, and especially because they have Lily, and I do expect her to go for the Jugs and not the Water Dragon. So it's like,
and this is also what we talked about last map with the giving Greymane the opportunity to kill people with CT and with damage from Kel'Thas, you know, taking them down to going in for the power slide. And then jump in and kill Li Ming.
Yeah, so as far as drafting goes, who do you think won the draft?
Oh, Viz Inerti again.
Yeah, it seems like they really did draft really quite well. It seems like, from my point of view, from you know seeing their draft plus bans, it seems like they got exactly what they wanted. They got the Vikings, they got their early game composition with ETC KT, despite the fact that KT was like last pick. They got the bans on the globals. I think they definitely got what they wanted. So
yeah, this is what they had in mind. They chose the maps. They chose Vikings early, and they got you know ETC and the Kel'Thas and Greymane. It's like the best ganking combo you can imagine.
Yeah, definitely.
Prepare yourself for battle.
Alright, and the game has started here for us, and on the left side of the map we have Crocodox with Shiny on Anubarab, Kadolek on Lily, Ankaru on Zagara, Amiria on Li Ming, and Sabko on Arthas.
And on the right side in the red team is Viz Inerti with Astacope on ETC, Pitter on Kel'Thas, Aras on the Lost Vikings, Ninetales on Greymane, and Captain Raynor playing the Rhaegar.
Yeah, and we're already immediately seeing the Vikings split here, not wasting any moment here, sending Olaf here to the bottom. And the rest of the team are actually rotating together to the top. Are they really going to try to go for some early game shenanigans? No, they're not going to extend to the tower. It doesn't make sense without the Sylvanas. But instead, they are trying to get some really early game kill, and I love it.
They're waiting for the top rotation, and Crocodusk should be able to maybe find this out, you know, get the feeling for it and do a safe rotation.
Here we go. And Anub is nice game sense by Anub. Not allowing any bush tactics to work on him.
Really well played on Crocodusk. Obviously, they played against Vikings before. This is just the things that you should expect from the Vikings teams to do, so you have to get the feeling.
Yeah, good job by them here, having the awareness, the experience to not just go and bush check it. Very good job by them. Olaf being taken by Arthas, very nice job by him. Gravity Labs misses the Arthas, which will allow him to escape pretty easily there, not a big deal.
And also Eric is pretty heavily pushed in the bottom lane. You don't want to face a Zagara with the Vikings.
No, definitely not. There, I think the Zagara is kind of their saving grace as far as picks goes, because she just allows to put... Ooh, and they are going to go here. Anub, does he have Boro Charge? Can he escape here? Doesn't look like he does, and he's going to be taken down. Nice catch here by this Inertia.
Great pickup. Luckily for Crocodox, it's a 30 seconds before the altar gets up, so it should be no problem for Anub to get back into the fight.
No, and by the way, Zagara, so much damage. Yeah, she has in fast, the towers are empty from ammunition, they are taking damage there, forcing the Viking to Hearthstone back. Doesn't look like Zagara is rotating to help their teammates instead. Oh, I think she messed up the temple. She's at the wrong altar.
Oh. Yeah, it seems that the red team is focusing on getting two altars, and it's going to be a fight down here at the middle temple.
Yeah, a little bit of a hiccup here by Zagara, going to the wrong altar, potentially not allowing her to get an easy altar here. But instead, they are going to go for a fight here, and it should be in the favor of Crocodox. They don't have the Viking player, so they are outnumbering, but instead it seems like they are on the chase here, with Arthas being killed here by Greyman, just going ham on him. Good job by Greyman, this is a 1-for-0, but they are so low, they need to give their Liming a reset. The Liming needs a reset, and KT being taken down, and Liming is getting her reset, but she's not in a position to actually snowball here. Olaf will be taken out by Lily? Yes.
Yeah, a bit of a misplay from Vistanarty here. You don't want to focus on your own altar with the Vikings, so you want to capture one of the neutral or the enemy's altar. So they ended up in a 4v5, which was maybe a bit more than it could chew.
Yeah,
and but
still a good job by Crocodox, all things considered, managing to snag the shrine there.
Yeah, really well played. Maybe they were more ready for this than we expected.
Yeah, a little bit of a hiccup at the beginning with the Zagara's misposition there, but they managed to eventually, you know.
You might be some league nerves.
Yeah, definitely happens to all of us.
Yeah. Oh, it's going to be a rotation for the top lane, but Crocodox already snuffed it out and is going back.
Yeah, definitely good job by them. But I feel like even if they would have managed to get there in time, Vistanesha, the ETC was a little bit too ahead of his teammates, so they need to stick a little bit closer to make sure that whenever he does go for the power slide, KT can follow up immediately with the gravity lamps.
And I get the feeling now that haven't gotten a pick in a while, they're getting split up and they're not in the focus for these ganks. But it seems like they're getting up here for a bush attack.
Yeah, and I love it. They need to make something happen here. Zagara is going home at the bottom, but what are they doing on the side of this inertia? They're not getting anything. Li Ming is being isolated here. Nice power slide by ETC. She's running, but to the wrong way because she doesn't have any option here. And KT grabs her with the gravity laps, and Greyman finishes her off. Nice job by them, but still, they need to get a lot more done, I feel like. I mean, you have Arthas in the middle, getting a lot of pressure on the towers there. Zagara does whatever she wants to, because honestly, the Viking can't really contest her. So it feels like Viz and Usha, they need to get some more rotation done here much faster. And they are rotating on Zagara here. She is isolated, but it looks like she will just barely manage to escape. Yeah, nice catch by Arthas, denying the ETC from sliding on her. Ooh!
Oh, great pickup for the Vikings, getting that shrine.
Oh, and the Li Ming, okay. They're getting the reset there on Olaf.
Also, Vikings capping the top camp, so they're still getting that split push all over the map. But they're behind on levels. Near level.
Definitely. So it seems like the Viking is not working for them as they would expect. It feels like their early game ganking potential is just not showing up. It's just not happening. And you know, meanwhile, while they are trying to gank people at the top and in the middle, Zagara's just going ham freely at the bottom. Arthas is securing the XP in the middle, not losing the soak there. And you know, anyway, he's tough to kill. So it doesn't look like things are happening the way Viz and Usha hoped for, despite the fact that it felt like they got exactly what they wanted from the draft.
Yeah, and I think Crocodox is really playing a splendid game here, playing it really safe. You know, they don't have to go for the kills, they just want to XP and get the shrines. But Arthas is getting killed here in the middle lane. It's going to get away. It
gets wow, 100 hit points. Almost. Wow. But Crocodox just hit their level 10, which means they got the heroics, which means that this shrine should not be contested by this inertia. We're gonna have a Nidus network here from Zagara, not my favorite. Wave of force here from Li Ming, expected to be a response here for the ETC. We're gonna have Syndra Gossa for Arthas here, very strong pick. Lili and Anub still haven't locked their decision. Anub gonna go with the cocoon and Lili with the jugs.
Would you think that Nidus network is just another way to counter the Vikings? Now the Vikings can't push any lane because Zagara might be there.
You know what?
Come there and do the damage.
Oh, by the way, before we talk about this, ETC is getting caught in an awkward position, but they do have level 10 and he does get the mosh. Two-man mosh, it gets interrupted by Li Ming there. He's still very low here. He might be taken down, but so is Arthas and Anub. And the front line for Crocodox is disappearing here. KT doing fantastic job there with his gravity lapse and living bomb. And wow, I actually thought this would be a shrine secured for Crocodox considering they had level 10.
Yeah, they weren't aggressive enough, but they gave Viz and Arty the time to hit 10, and they just went in for the kills, and there was no immediate response from Crocodox.
Yeah, and by the way, about your question about the Nidus, I would generally agree, except that, you know, minus the team fight that we've seen so far, the Crocodox were actually in the lead, so do you really need this extra pressure on the Vikings? I mean, you're already doing a really good job dealing with them. Ooh, and they are going to go for the gank here, and Anubarak is getting caught a little bit of position. Does he have Boro Charge? It doesn't look like it, and Lili is getting caught by the Gravity Lapse here. Nice job by KT, and will the Phoenix finish off? Yes, it does.
Great pickup on Viz and Arty. Now they're getting the value that they want. Sometimes it takes until the late game before you feel you can pull it off. And another attempt going for Anubarak, but he should be able to get out from there. Red
team has destroyed a fort. Yeah, so they will get the fort here, the first fort in the game here. Zagara is doing a lot of work at the bottom lane here. She is getting the fort to half hit points there. She might be able to take it down, but it seems like Viz and Usha are quick with the rotation on her. And look at ETC, he's aggressively going to the bottom there, but Arthas is getting caught a bit here by KT is getting caught here by Arthas, denying him the rotation.
And they do manage to get the bottom fort. So, and they're going to grab the top fort, so it's going to be forts ahead for Crocodox, and they'll get a good chunk of XP from those forts.
Yeah. And they should hit level 13 before the altar actually spawns, so they should be equal on talent, so not a big deal there. But yeah, I feel like the more there, the not taking the more, considering how early game went for them, I think it might be a bad decision there with the Nidus, especially considering they have an ETC. Should they have the wave of force? But what if it's on cooldown, and what if she's forced to use it defensively at some point? I don't know, we'll have to see how it plays out.
That extra interrupt could be fatal. Right now, He just needs to interrupt two people, get two people in the marsh for it to be safely going off. Great gravid less on a noob. Greyman going in. Arf is a bit out of position here. Can they bring him down? And they do.
Oh, and this was a one-man mosh here, kind of whiffed off, catching Zagara here, not a big impact. She didn't get any damage despite the fact of being in the mosh. Rhaegar is dropping very low here, Katie as well. Li Ming is still alive. If they can manage to get a kill here, she will get her reset, and it can snowball very, very quickly here. They need to get her the reset. Can they get it? No, it seems like Anub will die here, maybe? No, he gets the board charge. Nice god. Oh, and the resets are starting here. Can Li Ming snowball it? Doesn't look like it. She's very low here, and Greyman is on her. And Baylog snipes Li Ming there. Nice job by Baylog there.
Really important kill. Unless they had gotten that kill, they might have to have turned back. But now it seems like Vision turning, it's getting another shrine.
Yeah. Ooh, and Zagara is getting here, caught by ETC with his power slide. Greyman's going here with a jump and does get the kill on her. They are so, so low here on the side of this inertia. And despite that, Crocodox, they didn't manage to take a kill here. They didn't allow to their Li Ming to get a reset early enough in the game. Sure, she got a reset, but it felt like it was a little bit too late here. So Li Ming, oh, we have a pause here. It seems like.
Yeah, that seems like that.
A drop from Discord. Okay.
I do feel like Crocodox, it feels like the teamfights goes their way in the beginning, but they slowly lose them because maybe Lily can't keep them alive against this Kalfas and the Greymane. They need to be more determined to get these kills when they get them low.
Definitely. Let's look at the healing output here by Lily. Only 13k heal done as opposed to Rhaegar with his 20k. So there's a huge difference here with the healing output. And it feels like it's a problem when you're facing both KT and a Greyman. Like, the damage output can be so big, so quick, that Jugs, they just cannot get full value. And so the healing output eventually just, you know, it's not there just yet.
Yeah, it's more like an ultimate you have to use preemptively. Just like Arthas, Legion of the Northrend. Seems like Lily's a bit out of position. Let's see if they can grab the power slide. Yes, Lily's going down here. Great pickup from Visnoati.
Yeah, definitely. And I feel like, you know what, even though you're saying it should be used preemptively, I feel like even if they would preemptively use Jugs, I don't think it would be enough. They have so much burst between Katie and Greymane that I'm not sure that even preemptive Jugs would help here.
No, I think you're correct, but that's pretty much all they can do.
Yeah.
So Gara pushing alone in the bot lane again, but
they are rotating on her.
If they can catch her. But she's playing safe, she's playing good. Okay. She used her vision.
Ooh, can the power slide connect? It does connect! Can the gravity lapse connect? It does connect, and everything connects. Oh my god, this was an amazing kill. I actually thought she was gonna make it. But the ETC just managed to slide on her, barely, like, with the edge there.
It was a great power slide, and I was certain she was getting away. And it's perfect for timing for her ult to face. They need to play aggressive now. They want to grab all of this with the Vikings.
Yeah, definitely. That kill was disaster for Crocodox. It actually opens up the potential. No, they managed to at least secure one altar, so it's not as bad as it could be. But Arthas is getting caught here by Gravity Labs, and KT deletes him there together with the Greymane. And they are doing so much work together. And Anubarak as well getting caught here. Nice slide there, securing the kill. And wow, this is just starting to snowball as far as teamfight goes.
Yeah, and they're also going for boss here. 28 for 13, 2 down on Crocodox, and they're going for boss. Let's see if Lilith sniffs this out.
I don't think it would matter. Even if she does, what can she possibly do? Both tanks are down, there's no way they can contest it.
Yeah. Throw some blinding winds and, you know.
Yeah, but
go around with a serpent. Doesn't do that much.
And this game looks like it's gonna go for this inertia. They have such a huge lead here, but Crocodox, they have level 16 finally. They are equal on talents. They are behind two levels, and I feel like this is the moment where they need to make something happen. They need to group up, and they need to be aggressive right now. They cannot wait for level 20. There's no way they'll, as it seems like, considering they have only 9 points left on their core, there's no way they'll even live to get to level 20 here. So they need to make something happen right now.
I think you're absolutely correct here, Heartless. They need to win a team fight and grab a fort and try to snowball it. It seems like they're on the retreat, and it's Visnoati who grabs the fort.
Ooh, Arthas, nice motion really by TC. He did drop low, but the Arthas is getting taken care of instead. Almost a kill there on the ETC, but then Threshold connected and it followed out by the Arthas kill. And Anubarak has the Living Bomb, should live there. And yeah, he does. If he just he spreads a little bit of love, but not a big deal. But still, it's another kill, and that means that Vis Inertia now has level 20. And Crocodux won't have level 20 for a very long time here.
Yeah, and I feel like it's been like two solo players, the Vikings and Sagara, and just the four-man Rome squad from Vis Inertia is just so much stronger. And let's see if they can grab double temple here.
They should be. Arthas is still dead, though. So. Blue team has
destroyed the fort. There's loads of interrupt on the blue team, but I don't think they'll pass through this.
They need to be careful. There's no Mosh. ETC is dropping low. There's no Ancestral as well. They are down two big heroics on the side of Crocodox. They have all heroics available except for Arthas, which is in Dogosa. And they're still not 20 just yet there.
Yeah. Now they're 20 on Vis Inertia. Let's see if they're going to. How they're going to use this to their advantage, because they are going in.
They need to start playing aggressive Croco. Now they are talent behind, and no, Lily is getting caught here by the ETC power slide here. She pumps Jug, but it doesn't look like it's gonna be enough here. No, Arthas getting deleted here, and Anubarak is dropping low, but he does have Borrowed Charge, which allows him to escape there. But still, it's a 1-for-0 here, and they have 20. And I think this skill alone kinda secured the game here.
Yeah, I think it's going to be really difficult for Crocodux to come back from here. But they're actually pushing Vis Inertia back here, and you know, every second trying to get to 20 is a good second, while Sagara does this push in the bottom lane together with two potential camps.
Yeah, but
six damage on the core.
I agree, but the problem is Alters are gonna spawn and they won't have 20, doesn't look like it. So how do you win from that? Ooh, and Lily getting grabbed here and completely deleted there. And this is game. This is it for them. And a nice mosh there. Yeah, that's it for them.
Yeah, the ult is going to spawn any second, and there's just three health left on the core, and it's going to be a breeze for Vis Inertia.
Definitely here. And by the way, let's look at the stats here. Greymane, top damage here with 55,000 damage here, followed by KT with 39. So he's doing a lot of work here. And on the side of Crocodox, we actually have Li Ming with a 50k, very close to Greymane, but still slightly behind. But it's just not enough. It was just not enough throughout the game.
And we can also see the Sagara, who's been split pushing all game long, is still just half the experience that the Lost Vikings has been able to get during this game. It's just not enough.
Then there's no way they can contest it. Anubis still dead here, and Arthas getting the power slide into the combo. Li Ming dropping very, very low there. She will be taken down by Greymane there, and the Arthur was secured by the Vikings, and that's game.
GG
by both teams. Congratulations to Vis Inertia for their 2-0 there. Had a little bit of a rough time at the beginning with their draft. Not the draft, sorry, with their game. But they managed to catch up post-10. So congratulations to them.
Yeah, really well done. And I've seen this happen before with the Vikings, that everyone, even I today, expect them to, you know, get an XP lead really fast, but it's actually after 10 when they really start to snowball things.
Yep, definitely. Let me see if we can get someone from Vis Inertia to Discord, kind of like get a quick interview with them. Let me see if we... Yeah, okay, so we have a response here, and yep, he is coming, so hold on. We won't go into a break. There's no need. He will be here in a moment now. So come and join me in Lounge 3 while we wait for him to get on Discord. All right, here. And with us is Aztec OP. I hope I pronounced your name correct. Congratulations on your win, 2-0.
Thank you very much.
All right. Let's start with your latest game. You had a very interesting draft with the Vikings. A very strong draft, yeah? With the Vikings and the early game composition between ETC and KT. we have to say that at the beginning it didn't seem like it quite worked out for you guys. You had this a little bit of trouble. You didn't get too many early game kills. Actually, Crocodox were ahead of experience. They actually hit level 10 before you. What were your thoughts? Did you feel like you were losing it? Because naturally, usually, with the loss of Viking in your team, you expect to be ahead in experience during the early half of the game.
Well, it kind of depends on which kind of composition you have. They had Sagara on their team, which means that they can push one lane really hard, and the Vikings can't really deal with it. And then they pushed with three people top. So it was completely possible that we'd lose the early game, but Vikings are also really good late game with Mercenary Lord and just being able to capture towers easily. So we were confident in being able to get the late game.
Alright, awesome. Do you have any question for him, Carvis?
Well, how do you feel about that Lily last pick against you? Is that something you expected them to go for, or...?
No, it wasn't.
No, you didn't expect any pocket strategies coming up here?
Well, pocket strategies are always possible, but I don't think the Lily was the best pick. Like, I can see it as a counter to Greymane, but it just didn't work out since ETC is really good at locking Lily down.
Yeah, but I can see it feels like you really got the composition you wanted. Is this true? Did you get the heroes that you were aiming for?
On map one, we really wanted Azul to be able to do a soak the two lanes, and then just a strong composition that can capitalize on his route. So we went with ETC and Kalthas. And then in game two, we went with ETC and Kalthas because they can roam well, which is something you want if you have a Viking team.
All right. So congratulations against you guys, winning fantastically 2-0. It was really, especially game number two, it was very convincingly, especially the later half of the game. So congrats to you guys. Hope you'll do well in future games. That's it for me. Do you have anything else to say, Carvis?
No, I think I'm fine with this. Congratulations to Ruins for Vicinarte.
Thank you very much.
All right, guys. And with this, the broadcast is coming to an end. I hope you guys enjoyed. Make sure to come and say hi on Discord. Make sure you follow the channel. Make sure you let your friends know about the channel, about the fact that there's an amateur league now in EU. It's not only cheer league for the NA scene. There's also something now opening for the EU scene, which is amazing. So guys, I hope you enjoyed it. I know I had a lot of fun. Carvis, thank you very much for joining me here. Anything else you want to say?
Thank you, Heartless, for bringing me to my first ever cast, and it was great fun to cast it, and I hope you watching could bear with it.
All right, guys. Well, thank you very much again for being here, guys, and I'll see you guys next time.
I didn't want to have it up or anything. I just wanted to try to concentrate since it was the first time. And it was difficult enough. Tried not to interrupt, and obviously I feel how much more used you are to commentating now, and how easily you pick up the stuff and are able to commentate them. It's really impressive. Thank you. Dino is in my team, so should be no problem keeping in touch. So thank you for this opportunity. It was really fun.